I personally am in a kind of self-imposed exile for the last 6 months. I left the country already before the November elections, when I realized that the Justice and Development Party government was going to win great again. My name appeared twice on the top of the list of journalists that are going to be jailed. And in fact, there were other names before me in the list, but they are all in jail now. So I am number one to be jailed. So I decided to leave the country. Of course, my family is back in the country, and I can see that many people do not realize that a journalist in jail is also a family in bad times. Children, relatives suffering from that fact. I always tell my end of the story in order to put this humanitarian aspect of the issue on the agenda also. We need to think about this. Journalists, despite the fact that most of the journalists do not have happy families, I do have one. I have a daughter, she was 3.5 years old when I left. And at this age, children usually have a self-centric understanding of the universe, and they try to make everything meaningful with reference to themselves. And when her father left the country, she thinks that her father left her, and she takes it on herself, and she says, I did something wrong and my father left me. And I have been, you know, taking advice from pedagogues and psychologists and so on, but well, all they say, and we have developed online games that we play with her every morning and every evening. She's cooking cookies, and in FaceTime she's feeding me and so on, just to make things normal and so on. But you know, her mother says, when you close this FaceTime, she starts crying. She says, what did I wrong? Why my father is not coming back? And so on. So we need to remember this side of the story. You know, every journalist that suffers in the hand of, I use the term Joel Simon from Committee to Protect Journalists coined, from the hands of the democratators, these are democratically elected but dictatorially repressive leaders. This is an emerging phenomenon in the world. It's not unique to Turkey, unfortunately. Well, it's also families, children suffering. And the suffering of the children will not end when we are back in our homes. You know, we will continue on suffering from the psychological side effects of what she passed through, maybe even 20 years later. This is one humanitarian side of the issue. On the other hand, I personally, you know, I am one of the leading editors of Zaman Media Group. I'm not just the editor-in-chief of Turkish Review, which is our elite publication reaching to the, you know, decision makers all around the world. But also I was on the board of Irmak TV. This is a content-specific religious TV channel that we were broadcasting just because of social responsibility policies of our media group. And I will come to what kind of spillover effects this takeover is going to have on Turkish democracy, on regional issues and so on. But the point is, I can say this clearly, you know, we are still at the trauma period of the takeover. We have been passing through, like, for the last 3 years, we were in the opposition. And we are not just any media group. We belong to the same, I can say, socio-political segment of the society with the ruling Justice and Development Party. We are, you know, conservative Democrats, you know, religiously sensitive people. Most of our readers used to vote for Justice and Development Party. We used to look at the personality of the Turkish president, Recep Tayyip Erdoğan, as one of us, you know. So we empathized with him. We voted for him. We supported his policies and so on. But suddenly, you know, he started to go astray from the original European Union membership prospects, democratization programs in Turkey and so on. He turned into a kind of Middle Eastern democratator, as I used the term. We of course left his camp. He has already closed other newspapers. The, 5 years ago, a particular weekly called Nokta was raided also by the gendarmerie and so on. But these were already, you know, left-wing or, you know, ultra-left communist publications. So they were normal enemies of the governance. We, on the other hand, belong to the same flesh, you know. Because of that, I said, you know, in the past, Turkish regime had been carnivore, but this is the very first, cannibalistic act of the government. You know, they are eating one of their own, and of course, this has created all kinds of traumatic effect among us. You know, this is not just anybody. You know, in the past, the ultra secular Kemalist regime of the government didn't like us also. We suffered during 1997 military coup also. But those suffrages didn't make this much traumatic effect on us because it was coming to us normal because, you know, they regard us as unwanted. You know, we were traditionally enemies, politically speaking. But with this one, we supported these people, you know. I remember times that Western journalists were coming to Turkey and they were saying, your country is not going well, you are not on the correct track, and so on. And I was trying to convince them, no, you know, Recep Tayyip Erdoğan is a democrat, he's not going to change, trust him, and so on. I remember those days. And of course, the very fact that one of us is actually killing us is making things much more difficult to take, to overcome. The psychological effect. And, you know, today we were together with some of our exiled journalists from Zaman Media Group. My luxury was I left early, so I didn't see that takeover day. I didn't pass through that experience. But those who pass through that experience, you have to see them, you know. They are lost. You know, they don't have the courage, they don't have the hope to start once again. Well, let me move to the second side of my presentation. You know, this spillover effect that this takeover is going to make in Turkey. Zaman Media Group isn't the largest media group of the country, but it was unique in several senses. First of all, for the last 15 years, Zaman Media Group had been the de facto school of journalism in Turkey. You know, we had trained and educated editors-in-chiefs, particularly design teams of other newspapers. When it comes to the digital media operations, most of other news, including pro-government newspapers, they were actually transferring journalists and social media personnel from our newspaper. Now that the Zaman Media Group is virtually closed, that school is closed. Now, in the long run, we will see how the quality of reporting is going to drop in the Turkish journalistic scene. This is number one. Number two, Zaman Media Group also owned the largest private news agency, Cihan News Agency of Turkey. This was a news agency organized that has offices in 60 different countries and correspondence with agreements with freelancers and so on in 120 countries. This was basically the window of Turkey towards the rest of the world, and it was gathering the information from all over the world, and this was number one source of information for all opposition newspapers. It's not that we lack opposition newspapers in Turkey. We still do have opposition newspapers, not as large as Zaman Daily. Zaman Daily was selling 650,000 as of the last week of the takeover. In the past, it has even reached to 1.15 million copies. So it was the largest, yes, we don't have such a huge opposition newspaper anymore in Turkey, but there are others, but they lack the source of information now. This is number two. Number three, we had started several social responsibility projects in within Zaman Media Group. One major social responsibility project I dared a lot was called Cihan TV Network. Cihan TV Network was providing free content to local TV channels all around Turkey. Local TV channels or local media in general are dependent either on the government or they were dependent on us. So those who are dependent on the government, meaning subsidized coming from the prime minister's office, they are inescapably pro-government. And the rest that were dependent on us, we were providing 18 hours of news coverage free of charge without our brand name on it, so that they could actually use that shooting as if it, they themselves produced it. So it was giving a lot of credit to the local TV channels. I can say we were working with 87 different local TV stations in the country. Now those 87 stations are not able to receive news coverage from cities like Ankara, the capital city, Istanbul, the cultural and business capital of the country, or Izmir, where in these three cities, and also in Diyarbakir, this is the Kurdish capital of the country, we did have our studios providing them free coverage every day. This is gone. So it's not just one TV channel. It's 87 TV channels have suffered because of this decision to take over. I will put one more point, and you know, I have lots of other issues that I can touch by means of the spillover effect of this takeover, but one major issue is the Irmak TV and Cihan Radio that we were running. This was also a social responsibility project. Yes, it was religious in the content, but intentionally it was so. Back in 2000s, we realized that there was a surge of radicalism in our region. You know, Muslim radicals were able to reach to the younger generation better than the conventional media. You know, the young generation were not reading our newspapers. You know, I have a daughter who never touched my newspaper. But we decided to broadcast a TV channel promoting Turkish Sufi Islam. Turkish Sufi Islam is traditionally peaceful Islam. We believe it is authentic Islam, but leave it aside. It was basically, we were promoting a peaceful understanding of Islam, in a mystical understanding of our religion. And in fact, I can claim it was a kind of virtual wall in front of the spread of ISIS or Al-Qaeda ideology in Turkey. Still, I can claim that Turkey is free to a large extent from the influence zone of those radical ideologies. But now that Irmak TV is closed down, now that Cihan Radio is closed down, we will certainly lose that ability to appeal to our younger generation and tell them that, look, what ISIS is speaking to you is complete lie. It has nothing to do with our religion and so on. Unfortunately, the government, knowingly or unknowingly, I won't enter into conspiracy theories here, has actually taken the leverage of say propaganda for authentic Islam or for Sufi peaceful Islam from our hands, and in the long run we will pay with returning terrorism, with returning rise of radicalism in Turkey also. I have to underline this, Turkey is no longer a target country for terrorism, it's a home country for ISIS terrorism. And it's not only going to be Turkish citizens that are paying for this, but Europe is going to pay for this. The overall world is going to pay for this. Thank you very much for your patience. I know the Turks speaks, they overspeak their time. I'm still a Turk.
Thank you.